నీట్ 2020 ఫలితాలలో ఎన్ఎస్ఆర్ ఇంపల్స్ విద్యార్థుల ప్రభంజనం ఆల్ ఇండియా కేటగిరీలో థర్డ్ ర్యాంక్ సాధించిన శ్రీశాంత్ కుమార్ అభినందనలు. ఇంతటి అఖండ విజయానికి ప్రోత్సహించిన అధ్యాపకులకు మా కృతజ్ఞతలు. 2020 జేఈఈ మెయిన్ ఫలితాలలో ఎన్ఎస్ఆర్ ఇంపల్స్ విద్యార్థుల ప్రభంజనం ఆల్ ఇండియా అన్ని కేటగిరీస్ లో 18, 35, 251, 253, 582, 606, 778, 812, 1821, 1031, 1349, 1303, 1375, 1654, 1753, 1754, 1978 ర్యాంకులే కాక మరెన్నో ఉత్తమ ఫలితాలు సాధించిన విద్యా సంస్థ ఎన్ఎస్ఆర్ ఇంపల్స్. ఈ ఫలితాలు సాధించడానికి కారణమైన లెక్చరర్లు మరియు తల్లిదండ్రులకు మా కృతజ్ఞతలు. ఎన్ఎస్ఆర్ ఇంపల్స్ ఎడ్యుకేషనల్ ఇన్స్టిట్యూషన్స్.
They are nothing but aquatic organisms. Why? Because they contain thousands of cilia. Why? Because they contain thousands of cilia. So if you look at in this case, the best example for this case is nothing but paramecium. So all of you know very well about paramecium. So here if you look at, so paramecium shape you can draw. Right, so you know that surrounding the paramecium, you find thousands of cilia will be there. Right, so here will be nucleus, vacuole is there, and you find what is called as reserve food material. So what I have drawn, you all know it very well, this is nothing but what we call paramecium. What is this is called? This is called as paramecium. Now, in the paramecium, you know that you find nucleus. That's very common thing, you know it. It contains vacuole. Moreover, you find thousands of cilia. What you find is thousands of cilia. So here, because of thousands of cilia, and cilia makes the movement of the organism to move from one place to other place. The best example is paramecium. Nucleus is there, vacuole is there, and thousands of cilia is there. Now these cilia makes the actively moving aquatic organisms. Means that makes aquatic organisms to move from one place to other place. That's why they are called as for ciliated protozoans. Now these they contain. Ciliated protozoans, generally they contain a gullet or cavity that opens to outside the cell. That opens to outside the cell. Okay, here generally if you look at gullet, where did we get gullet? You know it very well. We studied eukaryotes. Eukaryotes, they belong to protista. Protista, we have studied about chrysophytes, dinoflagellates, eukaryotes, then slimeids. Four categories. Fifth one is protozoans. Protozoans are again divided into four categories. Now we are in the discussion about ciliated protozoans. Now, because gullet or the cavity is a characteristic feature of protista, what I am trying to explain to you here is Monera we have completed. That's the first kingdom. Monera contains all Archaebacteria, Methanogens, Mycoplasma, Actinomycete, Cyanobacteria. These all we have studied. In that, cell wall is present. Coming to protista, cell wall is replaced by a protein rich layer called pellicle or epitheca in case of chrysophytes, pellicle in case of eukaryotes. See the comparison. So Monera with protista, we are in the second kingdom called protista. Now in protista, in eukaryotes if you look at, we have cytosome, that is called cell wall, cytopharynx, that itself is called gullet, and reservoir. So presence of gullet or itself is called cavity. Gullet, cavity, cell mouth are, and reservoir are the characteristic features of protista. Where do you find gullet? One is in eukaryote and second one is nothing but flagella, sorry, ciliated protozoans. So in this case, gullet or cavity that opens to outside the cell. So when you look at here, we find a gullet or cavity like structure. You can see that get called gullet or cavity like structure that get opens to outside. That's very very important characteristic which we have to remember about characteristic of protista. So what are the characteristics? We know oxospores, we have discussed in chrysophytes, that are seen only in protista. Pellicle or epitheca, that's found only in case of protista. Gullet or cavity, cytostome, are the characteristics exhibited by protista. And what are the other characteristics? Means what I'm trying to discuss with you, all the points are nothing but peculiar characteristics. Means the characteristics which are seen only in protista and not seen in other kingdoms. Okay, so what else we find? Multinucleated mass of protoplasm is surrounded by plasma membrane. That is also found in case of protista because cell wall is absent. And zymeworts, if you look at protozoans, generally they contain multinucleated mass of protoplasm, multinucleated mass of protoplasm covered by plasma membrane. Again, it's a characteristics of protista. Same only in protista, absent in case of monera. So all the points what I discussed with you are the peculiar characteristics, meaning important characteristics of protista, and those characteristics are seen in different organisms. So in eugenotes, we studied cytostome, cytokinins, and the zygoia. Cytokinins we call gullet. Anterior part of the cell is the gullet or cytokinins. The same characteristic even we observed in case of ciliated protozoans. So if you look at thousands of cilia present, that's why they keep moving actively. All the aquatic organisms who have cilia, they keep moving here and there, and they contain gullet or cavity that opens to the outside the cell. As thousands of cilia are there, then all move in coordinated manner. All the cilia move in a coordinated manner. They move in a coordinated manner. They move in a coordinated manner. And what do they do when they move together in the coordinated manner? Water laden with food stayed into gullet. What is the point I mentioned over here? All the cilia, when they move in a coordinated manner, in a row meaning in one direction, in a row, that means whenever you look at the cilia conditions here, when all the cilia are there, the cilia either they move in the forward direction, all the cilia, or all the cilia at a time they move in backward direction. So they work together in a coordinated manner, meaning if they are moving all to upper direction or forward direction, all will move in a forward direction. And if it has to move taking the food, when it is steering, when it is pushing the water back, when water is pushed back, that water, whatever the food is there, it will absorb along with the water and steered means pushed into the gullet. So all the cilia which are present all over the surface, they walk in a coordinated manner. Either they move all in forward direction or they move all in backward direction. That's the meaning of this. So what is the point which you have to understand here? All the cilia move in a coordinated manner, in a row. Okay, water laden with food means while pushing the water backward direction, along with the water, food is taken from water, that is small aquatic organisms or floating planktons. So the food is taken and immediately steered into the gullet. So whatever the food is available here, while pushing the water down, it takes the food and keeps inside into the gullet. It absorbs the food while they are pushing the water back. It absorbs the food and pushes into the gullet. It takes into the gullet or cavity because that opens outside the cell. Okay, so when we take the ciliated protozoans, so most commonly, most importantly, if you look at paramecium is one of the best examples. So I write here the paramecium itself is an example for ciliated protozoans. Now, next one is sporozoans. The last one is sporozoans. Now, when we look at the sporozoans, that's nothing but one of the category of the protozoans. What we find here, and these sporozoans are nothing but diverse organisms. They are nothing but diverse organisms. Means they contain the organisms which differ in their characteristics. A different type of diversified organisms, they fall in the category called as sporozoans. Now these sporozoans, they contain a spore-like infectious stage. They contain a spore-like infectious stage. they show a spore-like infectious stage, meaning sporozoans, they produce spores, and these spores are responsible for causing different type of infections. So spore formation itself is considered as infectious stage. So sporozoans contain spore-like infectious stage. This is very very important point. And for this, we can take the most notorious, which is most notorious, that's nothing but Plasmodium. This Plasmodium itself is called as a malarial parasite. Now this malarial parasite Plasmodium, it's responsible for causing the disease. Causes malaria. It causes malaria fever or malaria disease. It is responsible for causing a malaria disease. Okay, so if you look at the most notorious sporozoan, if you look at, that's very very important. It's nothing but Plasmodium. The Plasmodium, it's nothing but, it's called malarial parasite because it is a parasite which depends on plants and animals. And this malarial parasite is responsible for causing the malarial disease. Now, it causes, same time, it causes staggering effect on, it causes staggering effect on human population. It causes a staggering effect on human population. Very, very important. Okay, so if you look at this, the sporozoans are nothing but a different type of organisms and they have different characteristics present here. And sporozoans also the same characteristics, they are heterotroph, they are parasitic, they depend on plants and animals, multinucleated mass of cells are surrounded by plasma membrane. So characteristics are same because we are discussing this under all protozoans. Protozoans are divided into four categories. Amoeboid we have discussed for the last class. Second one is flagellated protozoans. Third one is ciliated protozoans. And fourth one is sporozoans. So same characteristics, multinucleated mass of cells surrounded by plasma membrane and no cell wall here. So it produces the spores which likely to cause infection. So the production of the spores, the stage itself is called infectious stage. So in their life cycle, they contain a spore-like infectious stage in their life cycle. Okay, so these sporozoans, they form spore-like infectious stage in their life cycle. So they are, and the sporozoans, you can take many examples from there, but the most notorious one, why do we say most notorious ones? So just 22 or 3 decades back, 1 decade means 10 years, 2 or 3 decades back means 20, 30 years back. Previously, malarial parasite Plasmodium is most vigorously used to spread, and most of the people were suffered with malaria disease, malaria fever, and some people were dying even with malaria disease. So it spread and caused lot of many deaths in different areas. That's why it's called most notorious. Controlling the spread of Plasmodium became very big task for the people. If one person affected with malaria disease, automatically it spreads very fast, and most of the people surrounding area also get affected very fast with the malaria disease. That's why it's called most notorious Plasmodium. So who causes malaria disease means Plasmodium. Plasmodium is an example for what? Sporozoans. So most notorious Plasmodium, it's commonly called malarial parasite because it is parasitic, it takes shelter from human beings, right? And when it takes shelter from human beings, it's responsible for causing the malaria disease. And because the most notorious, because of vast spread of malaria caused by Plasmodium, that's a sporozoan, most of the people got died, and it became very difficult to stop the vigorous spread of malaria. class only from one person to other person. As a result, many people died with the malaria 2 to 3 decades back. That's why we say whole global caused a staggering effect on human population. Staggering effect means it's a very big loss on human population, where people will suffer from 15 to 20 days continuously. They will get fever and they will not get rid of, and very fast, vigorous spread it has. So many people, most of the human population got affected with this scolopropans, and it's caused by a malarial parasite called as what? What is a malarial parasite? It is nothing but Plasmodium. Remember, Plasmodium causes malaria disease. That's nothing but scolopropans. Take care, protista is completed. Now, let us continue our discussion with fungi. Now, we just have completed Molilla and we completed just now Protista. Now, the third kingdom, according to R.B. Whittaker's system of classification. So, five kingdom classification, if you take Molilla, we have done it, Protista, we have done it. Now, let us go with the next kingdom called as fungi. Now, let us discuss about the fungi. Now, this fungi, it includes unique heterotrophic organisms. It includes unique heterotrophic organisms. Meaning what? They are eukaryotes and moreover multicellular and heterotrophic organisms. So if you look at the fungi, now fungi, if you look at, they are unique heterotrophic characteristics. What's the meaning of unique? So something, there's a special character that is found only in case of fungi and not found in other organisms. That fungi has its own specific special character. That's why they are called unique. Heterotrophic organisms meaning they depend on other organisms for the food. That's why they are called unique heterotrophic organisms. Now, according to five kingdom system classification given by R. H. Whittaker, this fungi includes eukaryotes, right? And they are multicellular. In the very beginning of introduction classes, I told you very clearly the difference between prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Monera, they are unicellular prokaryotes. Coming to Protista, they are unicellular, but they are what? They are unicellular, but they are eukaryotes. Coming to fungi, from fungi, all organisms are higher organisms and they all are multicellular, and moreover, they are heterotrophic and some are autotrophic and all are eukaryotes. So, the difference between prokaryotes and eukaryotes I gave in the very introduction, first few classes. Now, once again, we are going to discuss very clear difference between prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Once again, in upcoming chapters of cytology, that is cell biology, structure and function of the cell, at that time we will discuss in detail once again about prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Right? Now, the fungi, it includes eukaryotes, it includes unique heterotrophic organisms, moreover, they are multicellular. Now, if you look at these, it includes, fungi includes the great diversity. They show great diversity in morphology and habitat. So great diversity in the sense different type of organisms exist and they differ in terms of their appearance. What is meant by morphology? That is nothing but appearance of external characters. They show difference in terms of appearance, external appearance. That means they show diversity in morphology. Means they show different differentiation in different type of organisms. It matters a lot with external appearance. So they show diversity in morphology and also they find growing in different environmental conditions. So they show great diversity in habitat. What is habitat? The place where organism survives, it's called habitat. So they found growing in different habitats. That's why I say they show diversity, a great diversity in morphology as well as the habitat. Now if you look at here, some of them, so if you talk in terms of habitat, so let us call some of them exist as what are called saprophytes, or they are also called as decomposers, right? So some fungi, they show, most of the fungi, they show diversity in their habitat, means different type of organisms, they try to grow in different habitats even though they all belong to the same category called fungi. Some of the fungi, they are saprophytic in nature, or they act as decomposers. That means these organisms, they depend on, dead and decomposing organic matter. They depend on dead and decomposing organic matter. So here if you make, they depend on dead and decomposing organic matter. The organisms which grow on, which feed on dead and decomposing organic matter, they are called saprophytes or called decomposers. So whenever any huge plant has fallen in the forest on the ground, or any huge animal, then what happens? Immediately the saprophytes or decomposers will start growing on the surface. They break down the large complex. Generally, a plant body, a dead plant body or dead animal body made up of all biomolecules, meaning lipids, carbohydrates, proteins, fatty acids, glycerols and all that. So when living body of plant or animal, when it undergo death and decay process, decomposers or saprophytes, they start growing and they break down large complex polysaccharides or proteins or large complex lipids or fatty acids, glycerols into simpler molecules. They add all nutrients to the soil from the dead body of plant, from the dead body of animal. They break the large complex molecules, convert into simple molecules, and these simple molecules will be added into the soil. So they helps in mineral recycling. So the minerals will get recycled from the dead plant and animal into the soil. In the, on the soil, when all nutrients are added, next to growing plants or next to growing organisms in the soil, they can make use of those nutrients. So these saprophytes, decomposers, they are called in cleaning the earth. They are called cleaning agents of the earth. They help in recycling of minerals back into the living organisms. Okay, so let us take some of the examples. You can take examples such as, you know, bacillus species. You can take example, bacillus species. And some of them, they act as parasites. So these parasites, these are the organisms, the fungi, F means fungi. Fungi depends on living plants and animals. When they depend on living plants and animals for the food and nutrients, for the food and water, when they depend on other organisms, when fungi depends on living plants and animals, when they try to take shelter from them, they are called as what? Parasites. But some of the parasites does not cause any disease, but some parasites, they cause the disease. For example, if you take, you know, the very important example, the white spots on mustard leaves, the white spots on mustard leaves, it's caused by a parasitic fungi algo. It's caused by a parasitic fungi called algo. Very, very, very important. So this is very, very important. Mostly you have the chance to get it as in the form of question, because some of the parasites does not cause diseases, but some parasites causes diseases. Because whenever fungi depend so much for living plants and animals for taking shelter, food and water, some may be responsible for causing the diseases. Some of the parasitic fungi are pathogenic in nature. They are responsible for causing diseases. Best example, most of the time the possibility of getting this question, the formation of white spots where on mustard leaves is caused by a parasitic fungi called Argo. It's very, very important. So in which plant you can see? On mustard leaves. You can see on mustard leaves, sometimes you can find white color spots. It's because of the fungi called Argo. Try to remember Argo, white spots and mustard leaves. Similarly, you can take one more example. Even this you have a possibility of getting the question. Very important. Wheat rust is caused by, the disease name called wheat rust. Now this wheat rust is caused by, it's caused by another fungi called Puccinia. Wheat rust is being caused by another fungi called as what? Puccinia. So wheat rust means on the wheat plant you can see white color, white or brown color, yellow color patches. The disease name is called wheat rust disease. What's the name of the disease? Wheat rust disease. It's caused by a parasitic fungi called as Puccinia. So these two points are very, very important. Mostly you have the chance to get it in the form of a question. Okay, so here if you look at, I'll tell you again. So if you look at the fungi, again it's important. If you look at, it includes, what are the organisms? This is, it includes all organisms which are eukaryotes. It shows unique heterotrophic organisms. They depend on other organisms for food and they are multicellular organisms. So just to revise this, the fungi show great diversity in terms of morphology and habitat because every basic point in NCERT textbook and the local textbook is very, very important. So here, which shows, sometimes you get basic questions from the introduction, saying that which shows great diversity in morphology and habitat means you have to take the answer option as fungi. And which shows simple in structure but complex in behavior, if that question comes, what is the answer? That is a statement which we have studied in the introduction of Munira. So look at the difference in questions. The organisms which are simple in structure but complex in behavior. If this statement comes from introduction, what is the answer for that? That is, answer is Munira. Munira are very simple, bacterial structure is very simple, but complex in behavior. They behave very differently in different conditions. For that, answer is Munira. If you get a simple statement, because NEET entrance exam, most of the questions are directly from NCERT's textbook or from Telugu Academy, mostly NCERT textbook. So, starting from introduction, you need to pay attention to each and every point. So, whenever you get organisms, which question? That saying that, which organisms they show great diversity in morphology and habitat means, you have to take the option from them. They show different, they grow in different habitats. You can see white color, white or brown color, yellow color patches. The disease name is called wheat rust disease. What's the name of the disease? Wheat rust disease. It's caused by a parasitic fungi called as Puccinia. So these two points are very, very important. Mostly you have the chance to get it in the form of a question. Okay, so here if you look at, I'll tell you again. So if you look at the fungi, again it's important. If you look at, it includes, what are the organisms? This is, it includes all organisms which are eukaryotes. It shows unique heterotrophic organisms. They depend on other organisms for food and they are multicellular organisms. So just to revise this, the fungi show great diversity in terms of morphology and habitat because every basic point in NCERT textbook and the local textbook is very, very important. So here, which shows, sometimes you get basic questions from the introduction, saying that which shows great diversity in morphology and habitat means you have to take the answer option as fungi. And which shows which shows simple in structure but complex in behavior. If that question comes, what is the answer? That is a statement which we have studied in the introduction of Munira. So look at the difference in questions. The organisms which are simple in structure but complex in behavior. If this statement comes from introduction, what is the answer for that? That is, answer is Munira. Munira are very simple, bacteria structure is very simple, but complex in behavior. They behave very differently in different conditions. For that, answer is Munira. If you get a simple statement, because NEET entrance exam, most of the questions are directly from NCERT's textbook or from Telugu Academy, mostly NCERT textbook. So, starting from introduction, you need to pay attention to each and every point. So, whenever you get organisms, which question? That saying that which organisms they show great diversity in morphology and habitat means you have to take the option from them. They show different, they grow in different habitats because some are saprophytes or decomposers. They feed on dead and decomposing organic matter. Example is bacillus. And some organisms are parasites. The fungi depends on living plants and animals. They try to take shelter. They may cause disease, they may not cause disease. But some parasitic fungus are pathogenic in nature, mainly responsible for causing diseases. So these two are the examples of the diseases. Very, very important. May have chance of getting the questions. What is the first example? Formation of white color spots on mustard leaves. It's by fungi. Which fungi? Parasitic fungi called albugo. Very, very important. But remember, white spots, mustard leaves, albugo. Similarly, a formation of wheat rust disease. Wheat rust means in wheat there is a rust disease caused by the fungi called Puccinia. So points are very, very important. You need to remember, you need to practice it thoroughly. Similarly, sometimes on bread you can see the formation of orange color dots. Orange dots, or you say, and sometimes you can see black color spots. Have you observed any time? The black color spots is all on bread, it's mainly because of the fungi called as the rhizophus. Okay, so some are parasites, some are saprophytes. Let us talk about some are called as symbionts. So apart from this, you can say that some organisms are symbionts. Let us take some of the fungi are, they show symbiotic association with other organisms. And they are called as what? Symbionts. Symbionts means they show. These here, F means fungi. Fungi show mutual benefit and association between fungus, fungi, and other organisms. Between fungi and other organisms. Or you can simply write between the two organisms. But you can make it sure that anyway you started the statement with fungi. So you can write between two organisms. When you take between two organisms here, between two organisms, what's the meaning of this here? The fungi show mutual benefit and association between two organisms. Means two organisms, they are interrelated. One depends on other. One gives shelter. Other gives food and water for the survival. Both are mutually benefited. Such kind of interaction, such kind of association between two organisms is called symbiotic association. And the organisms are called as symbionts. Okay, so the fungi here, we are taking the example. And you take here the fungal. Fungi shows. F means fungi. Fungi shows symbiotic association with. Association with algae. Symbiotic association with algae. When fungi show symbiotic association with algae, now they are called as lichens, or we call lichens. We call them as lichens, or we call them as what? Lichens. Okay. So, what is symbiotic association? As I said, two organisms are mutually benefited. Now, if you take the best example for this, a fungi, F means fungi. Fungi shows a symbiotic association with algae. When fungi and algae grow together, then they are called as lichens, or we call lichens. What are lichens? A symbiotic association between algae and fungi, they are called lichens, or we call lichens. So, for example, if you take F is nothing but fungi, A is nothing but algae. What I am trying to tell you, F is nothing but fungi, A is nothing but algae. So what fungi will algae will give? Algae, fungi, algae will give what you call shelter. So algae will give what is called food material, food to the fungi. In return, fungi will give shelter to the algae. Okay, so fungi provide, it absorbs more water and provide water to the algae. So F is nothing but fungi, A is nothing but algae. Fungi and algae both grow together. Together called as lichens or lichens. They cannot be differentiated. If you see carefully, then you can see there are two organisms called fungi and algae. But if you look at normally, you cannot differentiate them. They are together called lichens, or we call lichens. Whatever is the pronunciation you can call. Fungi is the one which gives shelter. Fungi absorbs water and give shelter water to algae. In return, algae, you know, it contains chlorophyll, undergo photosynthesis, prepares its own food. Some food it will share with fungi. So fungi give shelter and water to algae. In return, algae will provide food to the fungi. Both are mutually benefited, and it's called symbiotic association, and both are called symbionts. And if they grow together, they are called as lichens. Now, in this relation, fungi is called as mycorrhizal, algae is called as phycorrhizal. Anyway, that part we will discuss later. Now, apart from this, another best example is nothing but mycorrhizal. Another example is nothing but mycorrhizal. Myco, whenever you get myco, that's about fungi. Myco meaning, F from writing, means fungi. Rhizae meaning roots. Myco means fungi. Rhizae means roots. Myco means fungi. Fungi shows association with the roots. Okay, so let us write here. F means fungi. Fungi shows. Same thing I'm writing. A symbiotic association with. A symbiotic association with. Roots of higher plants. Roots of higher plants. It shows symbiotic association with roots of higher plants. Such kind of association is called as mycorrhizae. Myco means fungi, rhizae means roots. So fungi, they grow along with the roots of higher plants. Whenever roots are there, fungi starts growing in association with the roots. So when fungi shows symbiotic association with the roots of higher plants, it's called myco, means mycorrhizae. Such as a symbiotic association is called mycorrhizae. Myco means fungi, rhizae means roots. Mycorrhizae. Generally, the study of fungi, it deals with a separate branch of science called as mycology. Study of fungi generally mycology. Myco means fungi, just remember. Now whenever the fungi is growing with the root, now what will do? Root will give shelter. Root gives shelter to fungi. It will provide some sugars, means the food to shelter and food to fungi. In return, fungi will provide water. In return, fungi will provide the water. So try to understand here. Suppose if you take, this is a root system, this is a plant. So this is the root system. Root is there. When fungi are growing over here, this is nothing but fungi. This is nothing but the root. Now fungi will take more water. Fungi will absorb more water from the surrounding soil. Fungi takes more water and the water will be given and supplied to the root. In return, root will give food to the fungi to survive. That means both are showing what is called as a symbiotic association. Fungi show symbiotic association with the roots of higher plants. So here, when fungi show symbiotic association with the roots of higher plant, it is called as mycorrhizal. So here fungi gives water for the roots, they absorb more water and they supply to the root. In return, root of higher plant will give shelter and sugars in the form of food to the fungi. Both are mutually benefited and that's why they are called symbionts. When fungi shows association with the root, they are called mycorrhizae. So these are the examples for symbionts. When fungi shows association with algae, they are called lichens. When fungi shows association with the roots, they are called as mycorrhizae.